My home country, India, has come a long way. In our contemporary times, we are entertaining ourselves with stories of underdogs, privileged people falling in love outside India or in Shimla, dance numbers that literally beat world's number one YouTuber, nepotism, and middle-aged hunks who just refuse to retire. But there was a time when Indian films largely echoed the tragedies of the poor, the defeated, the old, and the suffering. One tragedy, one of the worst in human history, changed my home country forever on 15th of August 1947. And one man who was there to witness it would go on to cement his people's suffering in one of the greatest works of poetry ever made. I do not believe in entertainment, as they say it, or slogan mongering. Rather, I believe in thinking deeply of the universe, the world at large, the international situation, my country, and finally, my own people. This is what Bengali filmmaker Ritvik Ghatak wrote in his essay, My Coming to Films. Ghatak has always been different from his contemporaries, like the more well-known Bengali director Satyajit Ray, whom you probably know for Pathar Panchali, a film that became an international sensation and kick-started the parallel cinema movement in India, a movement synonymous to the neorealism of post-Second World War Europe. But Ghatak didn't care about international fame or monetary success. In fact, his debut film, Nagarik, made in 1952, now regarded to be the first true art film in Bengal, predates Pathar Panchali by 3 years. Unfortunately, Ritvik Ghatak was robbed of that honor, since the film wasn't released in 1952, but in 1977, after Ghatak passed away in 1976. And yet, Ghatak didn't care. His sole objective was to capture the repercussions of the events he witnessed, firstly, during the 1943 Bengal famine, a man-made tragedy crafted by Britain's wartime policies, killing approximately 3 million people, and secondly, during the 1946 communal riots between Hindus and Muslims, as the inevitability of India's partition loomed over everyone. The riots displaced Ghatak and his family, along with millions of Bengalis, to Calcutta, now the present-day city of Kolkata in the West Bengal state of India. And then it happened. On 15th of August 1947, India gained independence after centuries of British rule, but at the heavy cost of losing a portion of its land to East and West Pakistan. Suddenly, millions of people were faced with a choice. Should they join the Muslim majority East and West Pakistan or the Hindu majority India? And thus began one of the most massive human migrations in recorded history, disrupting 100 years of complex communities who had coexisted peacefully but were now killing their own neighbors in the name of religion. Thousands never made it to their destinations. Women were brutally raped and tortured. Families were separated. The British and Indian politics rushed the independence, leaving behind a messy destruction and two states still in conflict to this very day. Ghatak's cinema doesn't aim to make epic set pieces that closely detail such chaos. Instead, his cinema takes place in post-partition India and is a scathing yet silent criticism of the deeply patriarchal, hypocritical, and exploitative institutions that enable such tragedies in the first place. One such tragedy is the epicenter of his 1916 magnum opus, Meghe Dhaka Tara, or alternatively, Cloud Covered Star. Just like the film's title, Ghatak employs a dense use of poetry and metaphors in both the sounds and images of the film. Something that is apparent in the opening itself, where we find ourselves in a fresh new morning full of hope. The sky devoid of dark clouds, and our metaphorical star, the film's protagonist, enters the frame as she is blessed by the sunlight. In the following shot, too stunning to put to words, she smiles at a man busy in his music practice, shakes her head and walks away. The man hasn't found his audience, so he whiles away his time entertaining the weeds who are growing by a river. The peaceful morning is pregnant with hope, beauty, and a potential for a brighter future. But the music halts, and reality finally dawns on the man. The woman is Neeta, who, just like the morning sun, is a young, passionate, and a hard-working college student. The man is Neeta's elder brother, Shankar, a massively talented musician without a single penny to his name and a single soul to appreciate his voice. We are then introduced to the father, an educated school teacher who loves switching between English and Bengali in all conversations. And then there's the mother, a bickering, taunting homemaker, always ready with the fiercest comebacks. Neeta's younger sister, Geeta, is introduced as a reflection, mirroring her beauty and the pride that came with it. Finally, there's the youngest member, Montu, a sporty, carefree college goer, boxing a bolster clearly not meant for boxing. In a handful of minutes, Mege Dhakatara not only introduces the principal characters, but also does so via metaphors that establish their personalities. Obviously, this is only the beginning of Ghatak's visceral use of poetry. This ordinary family of six live in relative poverty at a makeshift refugee camp after they migrated to West Bengal during the partition. This is a traditional conservative upper caste Bengali family, deeply concerned about marrying off their daughters and of their sons taking charge of supporting the family. Geeta is young and beautiful and has no shortage of grooms, whereas Neeta is a little older and along with the father is one of the only breadwinners in the family thanks to her part-time tutoring job. Montu is still too young to earn. Hence, the family has grown contemptuous of Shankar, who, instead of playing the role of the true breadwinner, wastes his time honing his singing skills that he knows will win an audience someday.
For money, mother, for money. Tanga ami to rozgar korbo.
In India, it is customary for families to give their daughters away in marriage and even bear the costs of all the rituals including dowries. So if Shankar really performed his traditional duties as the eldest, his sisters can be married off, Montu will finish his college and the parents will live out their last days in peace. Despite this imbalance that is far from traditional in conservative India, Neeta remains the only one to adamantly support her brother. She gives him money without question when he asks for it, barely balances her part-time job and college to make ends meet, and is still able to keep a beautiful smile on her face. But the film's title has already betrayed the fact that this imbalance will ultimately cloud our star, and we watch with bated breaths as it slowly and painfully fades away. The initial striking detail that you'll notice as a viewer when watching this film is the astonishing visual. With the aid of cinematographer Dhinen Gupta, Ghatak painstakingly makes every frame worthy of a moving painting. The director keeps a clear distinction between the foreground and the background of every shot, giving the film a certain depth as if we are watching it in 3D. This not only gives us a pleasing composition, but provides Ghatak with ample opportunities to bring his beautiful poetry to life. In one scene, for example, the mother in the background laments how life has been hard on her and worries what will happen to the family from a monetary perspective if Neeta is married off right now. Neeta, who is in the foreground, turns her head sadly and regrettably, an emotion that is invisible to the mother but not to the audience. Neeta knows she's the sole member preventing the family from sliding into total poverty, so she has to play the role her brother Shankar refuses to. And given her self-sacrificing nature and unconditional love for her family, she definitely will. Or take another scene, for instance, where Neeta is remembering a beautiful childhood memory when she had woken up early with her brother Shankar to witness the rising sun, while ironically the sun is setting down in the background. Mege Dhakatara is brimming with such poetic images, the background often reflecting a state, a mood, or an emotion of the character who is in the foreground. Just take a look at how in this scene near the opening, Neeta is drenched in clear white light. She sits really close to the camera. Shankar enters her room and mischievously snatches the love letter from her. But this exact situation is grimly reflected near the end of the film. Neeta, now significantly away from the camera and engulfed in unnatural blackness. For Neeta, Ghatak gradually lowers the brightness and even visibility in her background shots, as her family and her lover take undue advantage, resulting in her slow descent into madness. This also begins to affect her own bedroom, that takes on a surreal, voluminous feel, engulfing Neeta as if she's trapped in emptiness and loneliness in her own home, the crisscrossing bamboo walls often bounding her in a symbolic prison she cannot escape from. Of course, visuals become more powerful when combined with astounding sound design. Megheda Katara does have traditional Indian music, but Ghatak slowly piles on visceral and surrealist sound effects to amplify the unfolding tragedy. So, the use of a traditional instrument like the santoor conveys excitement as Neeta is in cloud nine over the love letter. But slowly, the sound design enters a remarkably metaphorical stage, conveying the blood-sucking intentions of the people around Neeta. The mother is upset over the constant visitations by Sanath and has a malicious intent to refrain Sanath from marrying Neeta. This is literally perceived with a deafening sound of food being cooked in the background. We have an idiom here in India that means khichdi pakana. Khichdi is a traditional dish staple in almost all parts of India, and the idiom translates as to cook up something or to conspire something. This is Ghatak's way of letting the audience know without a single piece of dialogue that the mother is cooking up a plan to separate Neeta and Sanath, a motif repeated every time Sanath pays a visit. The flawless mixture of all these cinematic elements are obviously reserved for the most poignant of moments. More than a half of the runtime in the film, you witness one entire normal evening in the life of the family, simply capturing the characters doing chores, discussing their hopes, dreams, and their futures. In the background, you can hear a beautiful melancholic song played by a vagabond, singing of one day crossing a river, but the boat by the banks has no boatman to get him across. Time and even the story comes to a halt, so the film can instead focus on humanizing the family and their longing for one day crossing the metaphorical river. The music, the beautiful visual compositions, the slow, languid movement of the characters takes you through a spiritual trance, as if the entire refugee camp has united itself in their common suffering. Ritvik Ghatak, like a master storyteller, obviously leaves the best for the last. Neeta eventually grows weaker, so Shankar, who has finally achieved fame and money, takes Neeta to a prestigious sanatorium in the hills for her to recover. In order to cheer her up, Shankar lists out how the family is living their lives to the fullest, now that they are out of poverty, their excited voices beautifully echoing in the hills. But will Neeta ever experience that same kind of happiness ever again?
Okay. idiot.
দাদা আমি যে সত্যি সত্যি বাঁচতে চেয়েছিলাম, দাদা আমি যে বাঁচতে বড় ভালোবাসি, দাদা আমি বাঁচব, দাদা আমি বাঁচব, দাদা তুমি একবার বলো আমি বাঁচব, দাদা আমি বাঁচব, দাদা আমি বাঁচব।
Meghe Dhakatara is a universal film. A universal film on the plight of people who are taken advantage of and sucked dry of all hopes and dreams. An institution's purpose is to maximize the well-being of all people. But if these institutions of governments, societies, religions, politics, culture are inherently flawed, they often have serious repercussions lasting even generations. Similar to how the British looted our country and poisoned the minds of our leaders, that ultimately led to a division that continues to affect people every day and deepen the hatred every passing moment. And not just India, but the countless other nations who now face mass genocides, racial or religious conflicts, thanks to European colonialism. It is possible these are forces beyond anyone's grasp, but at least art, or in this case cinema, can serve a mirror to how division, inequality, hypocrisy often leads to devastating effects that ripple through time, whether it be nationwide or in our very households. There may be countless silenced voices in the world, but films like Meghe Dhakatara will ensure no cloud will ever cover their suffering.